Hello and welcome. I'm Kathy Falzer, Vice President of Actions and Programs of Charlottesville Now. Thank you for joining us tonight for our program, This War Will Set Us Free. Tonight, Mrs. Molly Lucas Green will talk to us about her exploration of her own family history, how her great-great-great-grandfather was born into slavery and decided to emancipate himself across the Rappahannock during the Civil War, but then returned to bring the rest of his family with him. We are so lucky to have Molly with us to share her story. And now I have the pleasure of introducing Mrs. Molly Lucas Green, our guest speaker tonight. An artist and educator, Molly Lucas Green has spent most of her career serving children within the private sector by way of her expeditionary learning company, Infinite Inquiry Incorporated. Molly is a native of Evanston, Illinois. However, most of her adult life has been based from the fictional Tara from the novel Gone with the Wind, also known as Jonesboro, Georgia. In an effort to refute active misremembering of American history, her recent expeditionary work is based on the Civil War and antebellum America. Mrs. Lucas Green travels with an investigative lens to historical landmarks, battlefields, and plantation museums, seeking the multiple truths that exist in a complex society, such as these great United States. She holds a Master of Science in Social Foundations of Education and a Bachelor of Arts in Spanish with a minor in Latin American Studies from Georgia State University. Molly, I will turn it over to you and to our audience. Please enter your questions into the chat. Thank you.
Many thanks to Charlottesville Now this evening. I appreciate the warm welcome and your interest in my work. I'm going to share my screen with you all now and get this show on the road. Today, I'll be sharing the story of Moses and Mildred through the art and the sequence of my own life. I'll start with thanks to Allah. Unfortunately, my next steps were on the wrong road. During the Atlanta Olympics of summer 1996, I was greeted by a letter by my great-grandfather on his 85th birthday. Between Jeffersonton and Brandy is where the plantations of Moses and Mildred lie. And finally, the ancestors' guidance all along intended for me to have the liveliest interest in the children. Thanks to Allah, a young queen was born. In English, Malika Ayin translates from Arabic as precious ruler. From day one, the gentleman.
Evanston sits just north of Chicago. Racial redlining was imposed upon my small township just as much as our urban giant to the south. My father was sent to Evanston to study at Northwestern University. Instead, he was attracted to the large presence of Muslim brothers, always so fresh and so clean. They shared a corner with Hecky's pork ribs, selling bean pies, fresh fish, H&G.
And that nuclear family exploded just a little bit early after my father went a little dark and avoided his Catholic roots and his entire family until well after his Muslim marriage and my birth. It was my birth announcement that welcomed their communication again. In the top, you'll see from ride or die, my ride or die, Ace Boon Coon, my father figure and grandfather holding infant me with my blonde, blue-eyed, nappy-headed uncle standing in front and my beautiful chocolate chip of a big brother right behind beside us.
I was not surprised to have a girl. We had always referred to the baby as she. When I first saw her after delivery, her eyes were wide open and bright. Her arms and legs were in full motion. She was beautiful. Whenever I visited the nursery, she was asleep. When they brought her to me, most times she was awake, but would soon be asleep throughout the feeding. I thank Allah for allowing us to raise this child. At a time when road travel was risky business for people of color,
Gramps was the original gangster. It was America's bicentennial, and Gramps mistakenly thought that he was dying from complications to diabetes. And with his brand new splurge of a purchase in this big RV in 1976, one of his first trips was coming to see his brand new granddaughter. And there I am, hanging out with my favorite guy in the world. Growing up in that RV during the summers with Gramps and the family on those long trips, I learned an appreciation for expedition and also for the Dwight Eisenhower interstate system, which connected all parts of the continental United States for the average American.
From that rebellious family and on this day of my conception, I transitioned to essentially a 10-year-old with my mother's recitation. Pause one moment as we swap.
She's a bit of a tomboy and into all sports now that she's 10 years old. She's classy. She's sassy and sometimes a grouch now that she's 10 years old. Mom says she's picky with her head in the clouds, but can rule both brothers and stand out in the crowd. She's a self-starter, well-traveled, ambitious and cute, and with money signs for eyeballs, she's counting her loot already at 10 years old. She's too young to be grown, loves to read Stephen King now that she's 10 years old. One day she could be court judge supreme. And ever since birth, she's been a queen. But for now, she's just 10 years old.
Okay. Go ahead, push the button. Got to make sure she doesn't fall. Okay, so let's continue. Mom is great at her recitations. So as we continue, I'm going to share that charted by my mother's always adventurous spirit and one down for any kind of expedition, those next steps were, I guess, not so unfortunate because they brought me here to Charlottesville now tonight.
Now 69% Black, the Urban Center promotes its history of opportunity and racial harmony. Civic pride, in fact, has acquired an almost religious quality, as if on the seventh day God hadn't rested after all, but decided to make Atlanta instead, and saw that it was surprisingly good.
Late spring of 1990, my eighth grade Georgia history classmates and I were perched in front of David O. Selznick's 50th anniversary production of Margaret Mitchell's Gone with the Wind. The romance, set in antebellum Georgia, had been a gift bestowed, an opportunity to nap when the lights went out, or conversely, a chance to fully immerse ourselves in the drama that Scarlett created all over the Piedmont region. In the span of those few remaining days before our transition to high school, infatuated I became under the oppressive myth called Magnolia.
My favorite guy and I, my Gramps, affectionately known as Gramps, and all my attitude, high school graduation day, 1994. Next will follow an audiovisual montage accompanied by my paternal grandfather, Gramps, his personal journal entry as pertains to his favorite granddaughter.
A journal entry of Roy Allen Lucas Sr. Day after Thanksgiving, 1993. What I found out last night. I want to help Malika, but I have no idea how to get next to her or inside of her very defensive mind. On Thanksgiving, Malika and Skippy had a giant blow-up. It was just a question of time before the Third World War began. Not trying to beat up on Skippy, but he was not going to step in after many years had passed and correct Malika. We still do not know the underlying cause of Malika's problem. Skippy does not have the knowledge to deal with the teenage girl who has a lot of problems. Love is not going to solve the problems that have taken many years to grow and fester. She is going to have to recognize that she has a problem and then be willing to accept help from someone outside of herself. It is my opinion that she is not there now. I have some bad thoughts that Malika will never, ever reach the point where she admits that she's going down the wrong road to live a productive life. After a brief try, Skippy has given up. Connie and Kim seem to have put it down as a wasted call.
You know, I wanted to be Scarlett, and I was totally unaware that the world expected me to be Mammy or Prissy. And from the wrong road, somehow, those steps were guided into Tri-Cities High School, a visual and performing arts magnet school here in Atlanta. The arts served as a source of trauma and as a source of healing for me.
A correspondence from John Lewis, 5th District, Georgia, House of Representatives. Washington District of Columbia. 2, Miss Malika Ayin Lucas, 27 May, 1994. Dear Malika, congratulations on placing second in the 1994 5th Congressional District High School Arts Competition. Your artwork entitled From One Generation to Another was most impressive. I wish you much success in all your future endeavors. If I can assist you in any way, please call on me. With all good wishes, sincerely, John Lewis, Member of Congress.
I'm sure many students got that same letter from John Lewis, but at the time, it was a source of pride for me, and it brought me to a different road. Oscar Allen Lucas was my great grandfather. He was Roy Allen Lucas's father and my father, you know, and so on. He was the first great. Oscar was a bit of a recluse and an intellect for sure, but had been estranged from his own children, his own grandchildren. And it wasn't without my mother's intense efforts to bring him fresh milk and eggs while we were little that nurtured the relationship that was a like mind of reclusivity for the most part, sometimes a people person, but very similar. And his interests started to become my interests. I was intrigued by the photos on his wall and his intensity. We didn't have to joke. It was all about what can you show me before I don't have you anymore. Oscar died at 90 years old in 1996 during the Summer Olympics. And the following is an excerpt, a reading by myself from his literature. On his 90th birthday, well, at 90 years old, I inherited Oscar's thousands volumes of literature on what he called Negro ancestry, Negro history, family genealogy, philosophy, and Scottish literature, believe it or not. He was quite interested. And I inherited all of his work, and his work in turn became the start of my own work, but also during the 1996 Olympics. I was a freshman in college, maybe somewhere in the mid-year, I had a little bit of a break, but I was in a freshman introductions to education class and was required to read Lies My Teacher Told Me. And it was between the combination of that piece of literature and my great-grandfather's research and interests that my life began to go in a very different direction than I had ever intended. Greetings on my 85th birthday.
14 February 1991. I'm blind. Despite the pervasiveness of wealth and power, or the absence of them in human relations, my cerebrations have peaked after 85 years at speculating about the following: chromosomes and genes, genetics and genealogy. The African diaspora, which first developed thousands of years ago, yet much of our nation continues to be entertained with the fantasy that Africans were first dispersed worldwide less than 500 years ago, after the rape of the Caribbean islands by Christopher Columbus. Three, racism as threaded through the conception, birth, and life of the Constitution of the United States of America. Oscar is featured with his great-grandmother seated, his great Scottish grandmother seated in 1906. Very shortly after Valentine's Day, he was the heart of his mother and all the maternal line. He loved the women in his family. Unfortunately, he had all boys, and his boys had boys, and you know, it was what it was. The following picture at the bottom in the suit, that handsome, dapper young man, is Oscar right around college time, probably at Howard University. Above is Oscar after retirement, where he had gone on to law school in Ohio and become a practicing attorney for probably only weeks until he realized he hated it. And at the end there is his driver's license, where he was, how I remember him, a very old, intellectually sharp man who intrigued me with his wavy, silky hair and his dark, dark complexion, but amazing features. I was intrigued by him in every way. And again, I only had my grandfather as the other model, that I didn't spend much time with my father himself. And from Oscar comes The Road Between Jeffersonton and Brandy in 1862, what we've all been waiting for. This photo was taken by Timothy O'Sullivan, and he called it Negroes Fording the Rappahannock River. This is within Culpeper County, within the same square mile, probably within the same day, and certainly within the same week and year that my great, great, great grandparents crossed this same river. It is interesting to me to think about them being in this photo. It just gave me goosebumps. And so my trip to Fredericksburg, Spotsylvania, to visit the national parks there to research my family's ancestry and to find out more, resulted in the first pleasant conversation and interaction that I'd had with anyone of the antebellum period or representation in my life. I have traveled to hundreds of these places throughout my adult life, and it resulted in a friendship with the National Park Service there. And I've always been a fan of the national parks. As a matter of fact, all of my students carry the national parks passports. But from this trip to Fredericksburg, Spotsylvania, I discovered that my family was in this area at this time, likely on this day. And they were part of a group of people who, within the group of people of color, especially African-Americans of color, call themselves the first freed, because they emancipated themselves prior to the finish and the end of the Civil War.
Biographical data. Ancestors: Moses Lucas, Mildred Jane Willett, as recorded by Oscar Allen Lucas, July 1974. If the record can be trusted, Mildred Jane Willett was married to Moses on the 15th of September, 1848, when she was about 13 years old. Moses, who we now know as Moses Lucas, was 10 years her senior. As slave by Benjamin Withers, presumably on the plantation of Jane's owner, Pickett Withers. An 1898 statement dictated by Moses a few months before his death claims that this 1848 marriage was recorded in the old family Bible. He likely was referencing the Withers family Bible, as he and Jane were both illiterate. The plantation rolled for hundreds of hilly acres west of the Rappahannock. On the road between Jeffersonton and Brandy spread the wooded hills of Liberty Hall near the northern tip of Culpeper County, Virginia. Young adventurer Robert Greene settled there in the early 1700s. Three generations had managed the lands by the death of Moses Greene in 1859. Moses, the enslaved, was 29 years old. In August of 1862, along a 10-mile stretch of the river, from White Sulphur Springs near Jeffersonton at the north to the railroad crossing east of Brandy Station, the Green and Withers plantations lay. Jane and Moses, with several of their children, lived enslaved. As the Confederate Army milled around and over his owner's plantation, Moses was impressed into Confederate service as a mule skinner, but not for long. While August thunderstorms for 2 days swelled the Rappahannock, drenched the armies, frustrated the generals, and reshaped their tactics, Moses, while hunting for his lost mule, crossed an unguarded bridge over the river and made his way to the Union lines. A few days later, and several miles northward, the Second Battle of Bull Run was joined and fought to the shame of Union armies. But within those few days, somehow or another, Moses went back by stealth through Confederate lines. He gathered his wife and four of their children, and under cover of woods, weeds, night, and more thunderstorms, slipped back across the Rappahannock. And with his wife and two of their children, rejoined the Union soldiers. His other two children were lost in the attempt to recross the raging Rappahannock. The family cooked, washed, and labored with the Union Army for a while, but soon wound up in the District of Columbia, where it spent the next 36 years until the deaths of Jane and Moses in 1898. They had seven more children, the last four of which were boys. Of 16 reported pregnancies by Jane, four remain completely unknown. There were the two lost crossing the Rappahannock. The names of surviving children which have come down to us are John W. Lucas, apparently a farmer and preacher and teacher who went on to Texas, Lucy Jane and Mary V., both born in slavery in Culpeper County, Virginia. Born in the District of Columbia after the war were Nancy, Celia, Lizzie, and four boys, Moses Grant, George, Joseph Henry, and James Oscar.
And finally, the guidance of my ancestors were at my feet all along. However, it was not until 1996 and beyond that I was exposed to what their intentions were for me. And it was certainly to maintain a lively interest in the children. And today, that is what I do. I tour the world, but specifically at the moment, the Southern United States, going to plantation museums, traveling to historic sites, primarily to investigate the items that are forbidden to be taught in most public schools and private schools across the country, which would be African-American history, which is directly American history. And dare I say, a shame on us for not including it. James Oscar essentially was the last child of Moses and Mildred. He was Oscar Allen's father, Roy Allen's grandfather, and my great-great-grandfather. He was the recipient of Moses's dictation and recorded it in this letter in 1942 to his son Oscar Allen, from whom he was also estranged for many years. And so, salvation for me has not been reaching a destination,
but has been about being on the right road. And that concludes my presentation today. I thank you all for your patience with me as I got it together. I'll stop my share now and let you all take over. Thank you. Thanks, everyone. I feel it. I hear it.
Thank you so much, Molly.
So yes, Molly, thank you so much. That was a wonderful presentation. Thank your mom too. That was a wonderful cameo appearance. What a surprise. It really charmed us. Yes. So, well, at this point, I'll turn it over to Amy. Do we have any questions in the chat?
Well, I would like to know, Molly, how did you find this information? I would love to hear how you were able to find this.
So let me ask you, which information specifically are you referencing?
When you came down to Fredericksburg, how did you locate this information?
So my trip to Fredericksburg was only to supplement what Oscar's research had already proven and provided me. I was left thousands of original documents of our family genealogy from Scotland to Culpeper County to Canada, Niagara Falls, where our Scottish ancestor, Jane Ralston, went and decided to marry a Black man, as rebellious and crazy as that sounds. Luckily, it was Niagara Falls, but her children did migrate south and started the line that is what I am today. But Oscar's research, his decades of research, his decades of investigating Black history, Oscar had recorded everything down to the form of death for everyone in the line up to myself. I was the last of his recordings. Oscar had recorded every ancestral home from Jane Ralston in Scotland to Moses and Mildred in Culpeper. And so that research guided me to Culpeper when I finally had the time to do it. Raising young boys, it was just not the time. And once you finally become an empty nester, you're like, well, what do I do next? And so I decided to pursue this. I wanted to make sure that all of the descendants of Oscar and really Lucas's across the nation, because there's so few of us, that we know each other. I have been, we have people in the family who sat in college classes with their brothers and sisters and did not know because of the legacy of slavery. So it was incumbent upon me, just as a good mother and as an educator, to first know myself. And it gave me roots, the roots that I didn't realize were always there. It was almost like I was, some sort of aquatic plant that kind of floated around when a big storm came. And the big storms came often until I started to realize that there were roots. And even if they're in the land of Magnolia, they're roots. And I need to know where I come from. It makes all of the years of education of hearing half-truths and intentional misunderstandings so much more feelings of calculation to mislead me and mislead children like me, which would mean all children who come from descendants of slaves.
Yeah, I see that Charlotte's written, what were Oscar's education and career background?
Oscar began at Howard University after going to Dunbar School for Colored Youth in Washington, D.C., which was the only school he was allowed to attend, essentially. It was the school of the first freed children. It was where most of the more elite, the first freed called themselves elite. And as you notice, some of the children who were born in District of Columbia had positions of power in the schools primarily, but also in Maryland politics. George W. M. Lucas was mayor of Brentwood, Maryland. Moses Grant Lucas was an educator and the superintendent of DC colored schools. He employed many of his siblings. Yes, nepotism at its best, but we're all human, right? However, Moses Grant also had a son of his own with a woman who was amazing, and that Moses Grant attended Navy Ivy League school and went on to become a doctor and published interesting pieces of literature and shared with the world that he was interested in a Black history or Negro history, as they called it at the time. So the education of Oscar was a result of all of those things. He went to Dunbar, as I mentioned. He left Dunbar and went to Howard with ambitions to become an attorney. He was, dare I say, angry that he had to become a parent. He didn't quite put the two together, and he did not want to be bothered with those boys. And he was an absent father for most of his life, and you know, they learned from him. And so there was a period of time that without my mother, my maternal side, nurturing the relationship with Oscar and I, Oscar did in retirement go ahead and finish school. He did go to, I believe it was Marshall Law School in Ohio, and received his paperwork in retirement, but hated the idea of it after he went through so much trouble for it. So he sat around and read. And when he wasn't sitting around and reading in retirement, because he was already at a point where he felt his body was too old to travel, he got on a plane anyway and went to Scotland and investigated his Ralston ancestors. He stayed in the United States and traveled as far as he could go to Moses and Mildred, but the family who he was estranged from gives him a bad rap and says he didn't try as hard to investigate where Moses and Mildred's ancestors came from. Throughout Oscar's life, he was under the impression that Mildred's name was Willett. Willard was what he called her, Willard, W-I-L-L-A-R-D, but it was actually Willett with the two T's and the two L's, and we found hundreds of those people. And that was just through the family that Oscar did infect, which happened to have been all women, some of them marrying in, none of them blood other than myself. I was the very special one. That was Oscar's education. The long way to answer your question. I apologize. Sometimes I get long-winded. What else do you? Am I still going through the thousands of pieces of information? So I have essentially seen every piece of information at least three or four times. I've read all of his literature. His thousands of books that I inherited in 1996 at 21 when I was a young parent, I used that as my tool to educate myself, because I felt immediately after reading his greetings on my 85th birthday that I had been denied an information that would have helped me be more solid and rooted in this country and more proud to be an American because of how far we've come. So yes, I've seen all of those things, but many of the documents I have only been able to process as I've matured. And that means going back and rereading some pieces of literature. That means going back and pouring back through the data and the original documents and making sure I understand that Lucas men have weak hearts. So I nurture my son and his cardio because I'm a cardio junkie because of their weak hearts. Like everything that he researched gave me the tools at 21 to know better and do better. And he changed my life along with the birth of my son and the marriage to the most amazing blessing I've ever received, my husband.
Honestly, I love your energy. It's like, it's so, you know, if I can just say, like, this is exactly why we have to teach history. It's exactly what you just said, to give us the courage to go on, give us the tools to make better decisions. So I just wanted to say that. But actually, I was curious about this too. Charlotte is asking, the tours that you do with your students, you know, how are they reacting, and what are, you know, could you share with us some of the experiences that you're bringing to them?
Yeah, it began as me understanding that children need multiple forms of teaching and learning intelligences. We've got to reach them in so many different ways. That because I felt as though it was a one-way communication for me, it was like watching television, which I hate. Being in school was one-way communication for me. I never felt empowered to ask questions. I expressed myself through the visual arts high school that I went to, but prior to that, I never felt welcome to ask. And I wasn't sure, and I really didn't understand until my freshman year of college that I truly wasn't welcome based in the communities that I lived in because of our poverty. We did not have schools where we were fostered. The Dewey was fostered. They didn't want us to be creative and exploratory and inquire infinitely. They didn't want us to do that. They wanted us to sit down and be still and be quiet so everybody was safe. And sometimes that's the way our parents were too. Like, you know, don't get rowdy. I need you to be safe so I can go to work and you all behave yourself and keep that door closed. And whatever you do, just make sure you stay safe. So it was kind of that mentality that helped me see that it wasn't just my school. It was because I was poor. And that I was sure of in Evanston when I was observing the wealth in my city, Northwestern University, that entire township is wealthy, and there's two streets of poor people, and I was on one of them. And so I guess when I take children around the world, and primarily now in the American South, we are traveling in a luxury vehicle. The vehicle is essentially a 29-foot limousine bus equipped with a bathroom, a kitchenette, and luxury seats that recline and swivel and all the great stuff. We've got our interactive television in the front, which I'm presenting from today, by the way. I work in this vehicle pretty much 24/7. We have a film screen in the back where we watch film that are related, but every single food we eat is content related. Every film we watch, every audio book we listen to is content related. And we're having critical discussions about what they feel. It's an SEL included in every single aspect of the disciplines that are integrated and the standards that we integrate. And we're coming at this as though the children that I would have wanted to hear my teacher in the eighth grade share with me. How do you feel about that? You know, it's not me telling you how to feel, but how do you feel about it? Let's break that down. And so, yes, we have some moments, but in our trips, we also engage in high adventure. For example, just the Clotilda, we just learned 2 years ago that the Clotilda slave ship was one of the last to be found in the United States, illegally brought into the United States on a bet during 1860, the last years of the Civil War. While my people were first freeing themselves, this jerk was bringing people into the country under war. If you haven't seen the Netflix special Descendant, please watch it. So we are one of the first groups to take children to that community prior to the investment of all the people who have watched manufacturers poison the land there. We are the people that are going in there and showing these children how essentially the environmental racism is affecting this community. We're talking about these things from their earliest ages. We do try to start with middle school, but we really like to introduce this as early as possible. And I work with K through 12. Adults have started to get on the bandwagon. As you've said, the antebellum idea and how it's been misrepresented is a very compelling topic for people who are interested in why is critical race theory such a problem? Why has everybody got their panties in a bunch, right? It's like, read the 1619 Project. Go back and look at how your textbook portrayed the Civil War and then ask me again. So yes, we handle it very sensitively. We are very much concerned about their socio-emotional well-being when we're on these trips. And if we ever have to stop, we will stop. We've gone on recon missions and cried in each other's arms, my business partner and I, and had to take breaks away from a misrepresentation in the Civil War as we're walking through plantation museums, you know, and we are often, almost always, the only people of color.
Well, thank you for providing that, honestly. Actually, do you have your art exhibited? That's
The trouble that I had in high school, and I'm not an open book, but I'm an easy read. I will share these details because I've already shared it with you all. And I really don't mind it because I've made it public before. My high school was plagued by violence. I was raped by an educator who I learned today is still practicing. I was traumatized for many reasons, but art saved me, but also was something that I put down my paintbrush when my life began to change. And I have not picked it up to intentionally paint for myself since I was a teenager. So the only art that I share with anyone today is the art that I did as a teenager. As of I am still a creative person. I designed and redesigned a schoolhouse that was once a drug house, and then I converted it again to my own property and increased it by 3 or 4 fold. So I'm still creative. I paint the walls in my house, but there's something very painful for me still to paint for myself. It's been a journey that I'm still on. And as I said today, I met someone who I went to high school with who remembered me. She was in an art program with me, and she remembered the teacher who had abused me, and then shared with me that that person is still active and hasn't had their certificate lost. And so it made me start to think about, you know, hey, text your attorney. You know, can I still do anything about that? Because it hurts me to say that I didn't address it when I was weak. Now that I'm strong, though, and now that I feel strong enough to address it, I will. And so, yeah, I don't do a lot of painting anymore, but I know that one day it will happen again. I see a question here. How do you identify the students you take on trips and who pays for their expenses? So, interesting question. I don't, even though I grew up in pretty high poverty, I serve clients that are not so poor, and they can afford to pay for the expense. In Atlanta, if you all aren't familiar with the demographics here, there is an overabundance of people of color who are very wealthy, entertainers and actors, but also intellectuals. We have several universities here, and there's an abundance of people who find value in what it is that I offer. And outside of Atlanta, we welcome people on airplanes as well. So it's not just Atlanta, but my reputation is built here. Let me see what else. Absolutely, Charlotte. Absolutely, Amy. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Honestly, that was really a joy. You know, it's so interesting. I think, you know, I just want to share this. You know, I grew up in Wisconsin, and we did not talk about the Civil War at all, you know, and when I moved down here, I was so shocked by so much, you know, I just was, and it's so interesting to think of how regionally history is taught even, you know. Anyway, I actually always say about Virginia, this is the history here. This is the history.
That's right.
You know, I was curious if you, you know, from that, I know the exact area you're talking about in Brandy Station. Were you able to locate anybody else that was family members that may have been down here or the plantation itself?
Well, I'm an adventurer. I don't like flight as much as my husband, who made his whole life out of aviation. I can't stand flying, so I love to drive, and we ride motorcycles too. So we're pretty adventurous, he and I. And thank you so much for that, Miss Godfrey. I do like to travel through these places. Oftentimes, though, I don't like to get off the bus. I'm always just a little nervous about being in the South if I don't know enough about the community. And my grandfather, in all his wisdom, warned me about, you know, the Mississippis and Michigans of the world. Gas up before you get there, and when you get out, kind of thing. Don't let the sun fall on you. So I got a really good education on how to behave on the road, and I will pass through, and I feel the spirit and the energy of the place. But unless I've been asked to visit and been welcomed, these are still places that are somewhat in the hold of people who might be the sons and daughters of the people who once enslaved me. And I don't want to go upsetting people with my need to feel the grass and walk in the dirt, even though I love to be barefoot. I'm not that daggone adventurous, you know. I'm trying to maintain some semblance of my lifestyle without injury. So yeah, that's pretty much how it's been. But my trip to Culpeper, that region in Fredericksburg and Spotsylvania, welcomed a lot of people who said that they would love to help me see where on the Rappahannock my people crossed, which I was given immediately by email. So, you know, the people who own that land, some of that land has gone to a land trust, and I've been able to be in touch with those people. The city of Fredericksburg has built a Civil War walk of freedom, walk to freedom. I can't remember the exact terminology. I've been invited there next week. I will be there as one of the people who help bless that space as a descendant of of the first free Moses and Mildred. Let me see what we have here, Miss Jennifer. Thank you so much. Thank you. Yes, Oscar blessed me beyond my imagination. At the time, I thought I would have preferred gold bars, but I've learned that those books were much more valuable than any wealth, monetary wealth I could have received.
We're very fortunate that Oscar left you all that information.
Absolutely.
Sounds like he was not a good parent, but he was an excellent researcher.
He was, and he was an excellent model for me. His personality was spot on for me. I prefer people very close to elderly or dead even is better, because I can read all about their life and not really hear all of their mannerisms and tendencies that drive me crazy. But, you know, I'll take the living too. But yes, Oscar was great for me. He was just so patient and so interested in me and what I did and my art. He got a chance to come to a show. So he was probably the one that helped me see that I was truly a Lucas, and gave me those roots, even if it was after his death.
I think you were born an old soul.
I think you're right. Oh, okay, Judith, I'm so glad you got a chance to share with me anyway.
Thank you so much, Molly. I really appreciate you being here.
Thank you very much for coming and sharing with us tonight. Thank you, Amy, for doing that. Thank you, Becca and Charlotte, for planning this.